Here we go.
Thanks, Chris. What a great way to start our morning of worship together. Welcome to you, all of you who are here with us this morning. Glad that you have chosen to join us in this time of worship of our God. There will be communion as a part of worship today, so we invite you to have grape juice or wine and bread handy. And please know that all are welcome to participate in the meal today with us. Doesn't matter what your church background is, or if you don't have any at all, if you believe in the love of Jesus, if you desire that love in your life, then we truly invite you to participate with us in the Lord's meal today. This morning we have a host home that's going to be with us too, and that is Linda Drury this morning. So I'm going to send it over to her, let her say hello to you this morning.
Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to the worship of Faith Lutheran today. As she introduced me, I am Linda Drury, and I'm also known as Linda D to differentiate us from the other Lindas. We have some Lindas in here. I've been with Faith for almost 6 years, and I think I've mentioned this to some people, but I found Faith Lutheran through the online and when I was still living in Price, Utah. And I was so impressed with the outreach, and here I am. The decision was made, and I'm glad to be here, and I'm glad you are too. So welcome.
Thanks, Linda. Thanks for being a part of the team this morning as well. We love that you found us online and that you made your way to us, and so just glad to have you with us. So there are a few Church Without Walls announcements this morning. First of all, next Sunday, we are going to honor our grads. And so if you have someone in your family who is graduating from high school or college or beyond, we'd love to honor them next Sunday. And so I ask that you send a picture of them and information. Where are they graduating from? What are their plans for after graduation? If you can get those to Camila or into the church office by the 19th, this week, then we'll make sure that they are included in the celebration next week. So again, that's next week we will do Honor the Grads. Today is our annual celebration, and it's going to be at 4:30. This is a time when we gather together as a community and celebrate all the things that God has done in the past year and look forward to what God will do in and through us in the next year. Those of you who have ordered pizzas, your pizzas will be ready at 4:30, maybe a little before. Come bring your own chairs, please. Bring your own beverages. If it is raining, we do have a secondary plan. We will move into the building, and so rain or shine, we will gather today. Looking forward to seeing you all in person. Please bring masks. If we, especially if we need to move inside, we will need to have everybody in a mask. So please have them in your pocket with you today. And then starting on June 6th, we are going to move to hybrid worship. We are still going to do one service each Sunday, but it will be online and some folks will be in person. And I know the excitement of the CDC's announcement yesterday that those who are fully vaccinated, don't have to wear masks all the time. And as much as I celebrate that too, we just want you to know that in Jeffco here, there are still some requirements, some guidelines that we need to follow, especially when we're inside together. And so we have a team of people in particular who are wading through all the pages of all those announcements and everything to make sure that we are honoring what is being asked of us. So for worship starting on the 6th, like I said, it'll be at 9:30 online and in person. You will have to register, and registration will come out through Teams and that through the week before June 6th. And then we will start. And I just ask for your patience in this time of trying things out. What happens on June 6th will most likely not be the final product, whatever that is. But, just remember, as we're moving in this time, we're asking lots of great questions about what does it mean to be church? What does it mean to worship? And so just remember, we're also a community of very different people. And so sometimes in worship, you get what you like. Sometimes you get what somebody else likes. And we're working really hard, staff, council, leadership, we're working really hard to make sure that that we can worship together, which is what's most important to us. And so just be patient. Part of the hybrid worship then and being back in the building is that we will have a welcome team that will welcome you as you arrive, will help you make sure that you do all the things like signing in and finding places to sit and all that kind of stuff. And Sandy Baum is going to be heading that team up. And so we are looking for folks ninth grade and up who would like to be a part of that first face of faith. Say that fast. The first faces of faith that people see on a Sunday morning. And so if you are interested in doing that, please contact either Sandy or myself, and we'll get you on that list. Training will be given to that welcome team. And so we would love to have you be a part of that. So again, contact either Sandy Baum or me, and we'll get you into that crew as well. When each Sunday morning, when you come, when you get the link for this worship time, you also get a link to the week's bulletin. So I want to encourage you to look at that, because there are announcements in there that we don't make live. And so different ways to connect with the community around us in particular. So please make sure you click on that link and be in the know for other things as well. Right now, I want to invite you to just take a deep breath. Excuse me. Take a deep breath and center your heart, center your mind, your soul, your body in this place and in this time as we now join together to worship our God. Invite you to say the words of the call to worship with me. O God of all our days, we come this morning with eager anticipation. We seek to know you, to see you, to touch you. Open our hearts that we might experience you anew. Open our lives that we may be faithful witnesses to your resurrection. Open our souls that we might defy the gravity of the grave and live the life you call us into. May we, with shouts of joy, proclaim your steadfast, liberating love to all people everywhere. Amen.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, the mount of thy redeeming love. Oh, 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 here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hold by thy good pleasure, safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, and he to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, come thou font, come thou king, come thou precious prince of peace. Hear your bride to you we sing, come thou font of our blessing. Oh, oh, to grace, greater debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Oh, he's my heart, take and seal it, seal it for thy courts above. Come thou font, come thou king, come thou precious prince of peace. Hear your bride to you we sing, come thou font of blessing. Oh,
well, as we invite God to be present with us, or to make us aware of his presence with us this morning, we're reminded that one of the great gifts that God gives us is the gift of God's peace, a peace that is not found in the circumstances of today, but is certainly found in who our God is. And so this morning, I want to invite you to share God's peace with one another. You can say something as simple as God's peace be with you, and you respond, and also with you, or however you would like to share that peace. We invite you to do that with the people who are in your home this morning that you're worshiping with. We also invite you to pick up your phone and share God's peace with those who might be further away from you this morning as well. So I say to you all this morning, may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Will you please share God's peace with one another?
So the first reading today is from Psalm 133. How wonderful and pleasant it is when brothers live together in harmony. For harmony is as precious as the anointing oil that was poured over Aaron's head, that ran down his beard and onto the border of his robe. Harmony is as refreshing as the dew from Mount Hermon that falls on the mountains of Zion. And there the Lord has pronounced his blessing, even life everlasting. The second reading is from the fourth chapter of Ephesians. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Here ends the readings.
The imagery that Linda just read for us in the psalm. It's not one that we are really familiar with, that imagery of oil being poured down, but oil was used in the anointing of kings or priests, and it was very costly. And so it was used for just for special occasions. And I love the imagery, not because I think we all should have oil pouring down our faces, but because it was costly, because it was precious. God is using that imagery to help us understand and see how precious community really is, how precious it is, how easily it is lost. So last week we talked about how we make snap judgments or judgments of other people, Right? And I truly think that it is true of all of us. We all do it. So we talked about how we could let go of those judgments or not let those judgments be the defining word for somebody, but to step out in love. And we did that last week because this week we are talking about that gift of community, authentic, real community. And when judgment and when what we're going to talk about today, lies and gossip, when those are a part of a community, it is lost very, fairly easily. So we talked about judgment last week. This week, then, we talk about something that is way too true too often. I wonder if you do the same thing. Like, do you ever see somebody or experience an encounter with somebody and you decide the story that goes with that moment of encounter, right? Like you decide that the person who's being rude is, that you perceive to be rude, is that they're just being rude, or not that they just really truly didn't see you, or that they were self-absorbed because they just got terrible news or whatever, right? But we make up a story, just like we judge people, we make up a story about others. And then what happens, I think, too often is that then we take that story and we tell it to somebody else, right? Like, so-and-so, there was so-and-so, and they did this and this, and then like, it was like they didn't even care, right? And we create that story so that it somehow makes sense to us, right? Out of our judgments, then we create the story of why. Why they were just being rude, or why they were just trying to make our life difficult, or why that they don't love me, or. And then we not only we create this story and we put our own feelings, our own assumptions into it, but then not only do we do that, but then we tell it to others. And I would suggest this morning that we often do that telling of to others because we always look better when we do that, right? Like we always look like we're in the right. Or think about this. Have you ever heard someone say something and you make assumptions about them and then you pass along not just what they said, but your assumptions about it? I mean, I confess I have, just like I think most of us have. And I have also had it done to me. A couple examples. I hear this. I heard Pastor Jane said, whatever, blank. Clearly, she doesn't care about us or our service or our group. Or Pastor Jane is being too political. Which is made a comment about sermons that were being preached. Or, and this is a paraphrase, I will admit, but I talked to Pastor Jane and she didn't do what I wanted. Clearly, she didn't listen to what I said. Or the variation on that theme is clearly she doesn't care about me. Now, the thing about all these comments were, and they have all been said, but they were never said to my face. They were said to others who chose to share about me or about their assumptions of me. And now sometimes I hear who actually said it because whoever the person is that's telling me will say a name, but more often it's just, well, somebody said, and I want you to know. Now, I don't tell you that so you all feel bad for me. Oh, heavens no. As a leader, I know I'm going to make decisions that that not everybody loves or even thinks that's right. And I have a thick enough skin. I know people are speaking from their own perceptions, even if their conclusion isn't correct. And I also know that I do sometimes miss things. But that's not what this is about at all. It's simply some real examples of what the scripture Linda read for us this morning is talking about. And today we're talking about it too. We're talking about the gravity of lies, gossip, and inauthenticity. One of the most destructive things to a community is gossip and lies or half-truths. Whether that community is as small as two people or it's a family or a whole congregation, gossips, lies, untruths, half-truths, they all destroy community. If you have ever become aware that you are the focus of gossip, you know the feeling of being betrayed, of feeling like people are being two-faced, one face to you and another to others. You also know the hurt that comes along with being the person the gossip is about. And I think this is true for a number of reasons, but in part because way too often, gossip is like the game of telephone. Right? Like you start in one person, the game of telephone, you start one person says, whispers a message in the ear of another who then whispers the message in the ear of another. And they, until you go all the way around, each person telling the next person what they think they heard. And what happens by the time you make it all the way around the circle, the last person to speak the message out loud, often the message that is spoken is nothing like the message that was given to begin with. Gossip is like this. Someone hears something or sees something and they make a comment about what they heard or saw, and the next person tells what they think they heard, and then the next person, et cetera, et cetera. And a couple rounds later, the person, for example, who was hurt by something their spouse said, now is having an affair with someone down the street, and right, we might chuckle or smile at that. But this is exactly what happens when we gossip about others. Ephesians tells us, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. Gossip is dangerous and hurtful. And let's be honest, in the church world, oftentimes a huge form of gossip can be prayer requests. I have sat in more than one small group in my many years of ministry where prayer request time became times where prayer requests were shared that I'm pretty certain the person sharing didn't have, one, permission from the person that they were talking about to share that, two, correct information about the situation, or three, the other person's best interests at heart. These reasons are the very reason why we ask you, is this okay to put on the prayer chain? We don't ever want to share information about somebody who didn't want that information shared, because we each should have the authority over what gets shared about us. And so also we must make sure that even if we have permission to share, we are sharing out of love for those involved. A good question to ask ourselves before sharing anything about anyone is, do I have permission to share this? And what is my true motive for sharing? If your answer to those two things is anything other than, yes, I have permission, and my motive for sharing is so others can care about and walk with this person, If your answer is anything other than that, we should think very, very hard about whether we should share that or not. We should never share something about someone simply to make ourselves feel better or to make ourselves seem superior or better than somebody else. If we ever share information simply to make someone else look bad, we really should stop and not say anything at all. Why is this so important? As I stated before, because gossip and the sharing of half-truths and lies about others break community. They are some of the biggest hurdles when trying to create authentic community. a community where we can be truly our authentic selves. And this is what we so desperately need. There are statistics all over the place that tell us we are lonely people, not just because of the pandemic, but because we are afraid to create deep, lasting relationships where people really, really know us. Not just the outside, but that they know the good and the insecure, the places we falter and the places we succeed. We are a people who don't want anyone to see too deeply or too closely. And so we put on the good face, the fine face, and think that everyone else's lives are great, so I must make mine appear so too. Now, think about that for a minute. If everyone is putting on a face, then everyone is faking, right? Not just you. So this whole, I have to put on a good face because everybody else's life is so great and mine, even when mine's not, it's not true. But we don't really believe that, do we? You know how I know? One indication is the way that we greet each other so often. Most of the time, we say something like, hey, good morning, how are you doing? We use it as a greeting, not because we expect people to actually tell us how they are, but that the response will be, hi, good morning, I'm great, how about you, right? But what happens when they answer for real and it's not great? Oftentimes we don't know what to do. We don't know what to say. And so we're just hoping they just say, I'm fine. Or if we say how we really are, we feel as if we must apologize. Yeah, I'm not so great today. Life has got me weighed down. I feel as if I can't do anything right, but I'm good. It's all good. Which school is so getting to me. I'm terrible at online school, but it's okay. I mean, I'm really struggling right now, but it's not that bad. I'll be fine. Or I hear this one so often too. I'm sorry for my tears. They just seem to be so close to the surface today. Why do we do that? Why do we apologize? Because things aren't always grand and happy, happy, joy, joy. Because somewhere someone has taught us, or in speaking poorly of us, they have let us know that it is not okay to be not okay. And this is such a lie. It is a lie. Seriously, none of us are okay all the time. And so then how do we get to be the hands, feet, and voice of Jesus in others' lives if everyone is like, okay, I'm fine, let's keep our distance? Some people might think serving those you don't know takes real courage, and it might. I know that. But I also say the greatest courage comes when you let someone serve you, when you let someone into the not fine places and moments. Here again, the words from Ephesians: get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Be kind and compassionate to one another. These words, this mandate that is given to us, is why one of our practices around faith here is the check-in. Right? We do our check-ins in a variety of ways, but the bottom line is that we check in because we want to see where everyone is at the present moment. Sometimes we check in, how are you heart, soul, mind, and strength? So how are you heart? How are you feeling? Soul, how's your spiritual side doing? Mind, how's your mind today and your strength? How's your body and your boundaries today? So sometimes we'll check in that way. Sometimes we check in, what's your primary emotion right now? And if you want to share the backstory to that, then that's great too. And there's lots of other ways that we check in too, but it's always finding out about people. And we don't do it to make anyone uncomfortable or just to make you squirm, but we do it because love for each other is important. And we can't love, really truly love each other if we are judging each other based on half-truths or imposed information. What do I mean by this? A couple examples from my own life. So one night when we were at a council meeting, a person who was a part of the council at that time had received potentially not so great medical news. And they were upset and they seemed disengaged. But we did check in, and as soon as they told what was happening during check in, we stopped, we prayed for them, we acknowledged and honored their reality, and we got to love them. Another time, person missed check-in. They came a bit late, but later on in the meeting, they were seriously agitated. And I received the brunt of that anger that was not meant for me. And after the council meeting, the person apologized. They let me know that they'd had a bad evening at home and they came itching for a fight. And I just happened to be the one who gave them an opening. Or one more example. Early on in my time here, we were working on our vision and values and crafting language around our three pillars, why faith exists, what we exist to do. And I was at a point in one of those meetings where it felt like I was just walking through the muck and mud, and I couldn't do it anymore. I was just at a standstill. And I was scared of admitting that I needed to stop because it had been ingrained in me that leadership, you know, you never let them see you sweat. But I took a chance and I did. I just said, I'm sorry, but I can't do this anymore today. And you know what the most wonderful thing was? It was honored. And I can tell you 10 and a half years later, it still makes an impact on me. That was honored. My true self was honored that day. So where do we pick up the falsehood, the lie that it's weak to be ourselves? That it's weak to need someone else, that it's weak to not always be okay, that it's weak to ask for what we need? Where does that come from? Because we buy it, because we buy all those messages to ourselves, because we listen to the gossip of others and we assume that because we're listening, others are talking about us. Because we are afraid to be seen as lesser than. And when we live this way, we end up lonely and alone. We end up hurt and struggling with no one to hold us up. The beauty of being in Jesus-filled community is the very thing we so often run from. Realness, authenticity, really, not just in the good times, but in all times. This is why we encourage you just in one place to participate in the men's and women's 1 year to live retreats. Because those retreats create an environment where you can be fully you, where you can bring your authentic self, the beautiful, the not so beautiful, the scared, the sacred, like your whole self gets to show up. And you realize everyone around you is showing up too. And it is beautiful. Not always easy, but beautiful. Being in authentic community with one another is not always a walk in the park, for we are all imperfect people. Just like those we talk about, we are imperfect people too. And imperfect people bump up against each other and feelings get hurt and hearts get broken and perhaps toes get stepped on. But if we focus on being present with each other, seeing each other as God sees us, as beloved children, all of us, allowing ourselves to be truly and fully present, we will find our way together. Breaking the gravity of gossip and lies and the lies that we listen to about what strong people are like, about how our life has to look great all the time, breaking that gravity gives possibility. Possibility of life together with others, of life rich with relationships that walk with us no matter what. And this is amazing and challenging and beautiful and messy and life-giving. And it is what God desires for us. Will you pray with me, please? Oh God, we so often listen to the message of this world that says it's about me and mine alone, and that I have to be able to stand on my own all the time. That if I'm going to be seen as successful and good and all of that, my life has to always look together. But the truth is, and you know this, Lord, even better than we do, the truth is our lives aren't always together. And that we do things that we don't want to do. We do things without thinking, like sharing gossip or stories or sharing information about someone that we have no right to share. Lord, help us see the gift that true community is. Help us realize that being a part of community means there's give and take. That being a part of real community means that sometimes we're going to bump into others. That being a part of real community means, though, that those same people we bump into can be there for us in the midst of hard times. Holy Spirit, give us courage and strength to be the people who step into authenticness, into real relationship and community, in order to receive life that you have promised. Direct our feet, our hearts, our minds, our lives, that we might truly know the joy of authentic community. We pray it in your name and in your power. Amen.
When I was doing full-time youth ministry, I remember telling the kids that you spend all the time doing the things in Scripture that God tells us to do. You don't have time to do the things that you shouldn't be doing. And I love Jane's message today that reminds us that we come with our authentic selves. It creates the space for us to be reminded of who the Lord is and to put Him back on the throne. It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. So let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, you reign. All God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard.
Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. When all God's children sing our glory, glory, hallelujah, you reign, he reigns. All God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, you reign, he reigns. So God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. So God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns.
Well, he does reign, and we can sing hallelujah because of that. But he also reigns in our hearts and longs to be with us at all times. And in the midst of that mystery and that awe and that reverence that we have for our God, we also have the grace and the forgiveness that is received here in bread and in wine. And so I invite you to get your elements ready, to have someone in your home serve as your communion host for this morning. They can hold up the elements as we say these words together. So please join me as you hold your bread. On the night Jesus showed his greatest love for us, he took a piece of bread, gave thanks for it, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples as he gives it to us today, saying, "Take and eat. For this is my body given for you. Whenever you eat of this bread, do it and remember me." Then I invite you to pick up your glass of wine or grape juice and say with me. After supper, he took a cup of wine, gave thanks for it and blessed it, and gave it to his disciples as he gives it to us today, saying, "Take and drink. For this is the new promise in my blood, which is shed for you and all people, for the forgiveness of all your sins. So whenever you drink from this cup, do it and remember me." And as we remember and as we come, then I invite you to pray with me the prayer that Jesus gave. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. My friends, I invite you to come now to the table to eat and to drink and to be surrounded by God's presence and God's grace. Remember that when you give the piece of bread to each other, you can say something like, "This is the body of Christ given for you." When you share the grape juice or the wine, you can say something like, "This is the blood of Christ shed for you." And if there is someone in your home today that doesn't take communion, then I invite you to give them some words of blessing. I invite you now, then, to be God's children and to be welcomed at his table. Come, eat, and be fed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today with our hearts humble and full of gratitude for this day of worship. Thank you for bringing us together and that we welcome your Holy Spirit into our hearts and opening our minds to your words of community. Almighty God, you created us in your image. And so from the very beginning, we were meant to be one people. Yet we are reminded how we are different in looks, in opinion, nor do we have just one religion. This is our challenge, to come into unity and of one heart, one mind, one hope, and most of all, one desire to seek and serve you as our main purpose on this earth, and that nothing comes between us. Dear God, be with us, your church today, as we respond to your call. Show us how to listen and live as witnesses of your Son for the sake of Jesus. Fill us with compassion for the plight of the persecuted refugee and immigrant, that we may help the orphans of the world and protect the poor. Help us to see and hear in you those who are frail, unemployed, ill, and grieving. Heavenly Father, teach us, train us what to do in order to participate in your service. Teach us to stop focusing on stuff and instead focus on your kingdom. Let us use our hands, feet, and voice in your name and at your service, and that we may gain strength, wisdom, and direction for our days ahead. We are always listening, seeking, searching, and thanking you in prayer. In his word, I hope. In Jesus' name, amen. And now for the benediction. Go now as light bearers to a world in darkness. Go now as hope carriers to a world in despair. Go now in the name of Jesus, in the love of God, and in the power of the Spirit. Amen.
Waken my soul, come awake to hunger, to seek, to thirst. Awaken, first love, come awake. At first, the Spirit of the living God, come fall afresh on me, come awake me from my sleep, blow through the caverns of my soul, pour in me to overflow, to overflow. Waken my soul, come awake to hunger, to seek, to thirst. Awaken, first love, oh, come awake. As you did at first, the Spirit of the living God, come pour afresh on me, come awake me from my sleep. Blow through the caverns of my soul, pour in me to overflow.
Afternoon as we celebrate our community. Thank you for the service. We honor you and we praise you. Hope everybody has a great week.
Spirit of the living God, come fall afresh on me. Come wake me from my sleep. Blow through the caverns of my soul, pour in me to overflow.